欢迎回到一男一女旅行的旅。我曾经说来朱诺一天不够玩，要多来几次或多住几天。苦等11年再游朱诺一篇，介绍了在朱诺看冰川、看瀑布、看黑熊、看阿拉斯加民族舞、坐直升机、爬冰川、欢度朱诺海洋节等等。本集介绍阿拉斯加犬和阿拉斯加皇帝蟹，这是我们第三次来，今年五月的时候玩得意犹未尽。朱诺一年平均只有86个晴天，九月中在很多地方仍然是秋天，但在朱诺已感到冬天的寒冷。从游轮房间向外望，早上旭日东升，晨光绚丽，朱诺如美人初醒，晓色叫不睡，卷帘清气中。我们乘坐的旅游巴士驶过朱诺大桥，来到在森林的牧舍营地。我们是当天的第一批游客，一群混种阿拉斯加哈士奇雪狗，见到人超兴奋，又吠又跳，开心不已。阿拉斯加犬跟哈士奇一样，天性活泼好动，都是精力旺盛的雪橇犬。说到雪橇犬，很多人都会听到过雪橇三傻，分别是阿拉斯加犬、哈士奇和萨摩耶。其中尤以阿拉斯加犬的体型最壮，力气最大，混种狗体格更好。训犬师一声令下，12只哈士奇拉着6位乘客和训犬师迅速跑开。现在让我们一起欣赏一下他们的速度。这条赛道充满乐趣，两旁是构成热带雨林的云杉和铁杉树。让我们听听训犬师 Will 的讲解。
So G means right, H means left. You also might hear me give an on by. That just means keep on doing what you're doing. So I might give that at the intersection. I want them to go straight up. Or I want them to stop and just go scroll.
回到起点，不要向我们介绍狗狗的名字和习性，让我们和狗狗互动、拍照、打卡。
This is Hawkeye right here, and this is Bob, and they would love your attention.
另一位训狗师伊丽莎白带领我们探望出生只有数周的小狗，和他们玩耍，十分温馨。这些小宝贝超可爱，和他们一起打卡几乎是指定动作。整个行程约两个半小时。雪狗拉车的时间大概半小时。阿拉斯加哈士奇犬曾经是当地的重要运输工具，后来因为汽车的普及，阿拉斯加哈士奇犬渐被淘汰，数量急剧下降。当地人乔·雷丁顿有见及此，在73年发起长途雪橇赛，全程约1000英里，需时8至15天。轿夫和雪橇犬可中途停靠24个检查站、村庄，补充物资、取暖进食、淋浴休息。在本片尾有数分钟的原装录影，由伊丽莎白以英语讲述雪橇的装备、狗只的保护和各个标志性的雪橇赛，请继续收看。牧舍营本身是一个景点，最吸睛的是一条环抱两棵百年的杉树、横跨于西的吊桥，能静静地在吊桥上欣赏阿拉斯加荒野的景色，非常享受。只见绿树浓荫，野花遍地，冰水在溪中流淌，在乱石中游荡，参天大树，百草丰茂，带点清幽，漫步在林间，鸟语花香，风景如画，自然景色让我陶醉，与刚才刺激的雪橇狗拉车形成鲜明的对比。森林休闲本来是一种儒雅，可惜天气实在太冷，只有华氏40-50度， 唯有不舍离开，返回暖气巴士。对比木舍营，朱诺市区是风和日丽，一片暖洋洋。徘徊街头商店，看到有一家邮轮公司在吹熄皇帝蟹小屋拍片，好奇之下跟随拍摄队伍步入餐厅，点了三磅皇帝蟹，一边观摩学习，一边大快朵颐。十一年前和家人第一次来朱诺，吃过地道的阿斯加皇帝蟹后，全家人从此爱上了石蟹。上次每人半磅，清淡浅尝，细嚼慢咽。这次每人一磅半，大饱口福。崔小屋的皇帝蟹货真价实，重量以煮熟计算，连肉带壳六只 蟹脚才三磅。从下锅至上桌，客人可以全程监察，含随餐附送凉拌卷心菜、面包和牛油。每年二三月是阿拉斯加皇帝蟹盛产季节，但近年价格不停上升，即使是 Costco 的急冻熟皇帝蟹脚也要$40多一磅，餐厅的活蟹价更贵，跟它名字一样，都是皇帝级别。回顾前后三次旅游朱诺，各式各样的活动，从爬冰川、海洋节到吃皇帝蟹，动静皆宜，内外兼修。比起阿拉斯加的其他城市，这里更多姿多彩。但出外旅行就是这样，不可能每处都是蓬莱仙境，每次都有皇帝式的享受。旅游全在于自己能否乐在其中，是一种探索，一种体验，可以开阔视野，增长见识。歌德说过，人之所以喜欢旅行，不是为了抵达目的地，而是为了享受旅途中的种种乐趣。谢谢收看，请大家留言分享您的看法。
So my name's Elizabeth, if you didn't catch that earlier, I'll be here with you for the rest of the tour. We've got probably 10-15 minutes to talk about the winter side of dog sledding, racing, gear that we use in the winter, and then we'll go drink some hot chocolate, sit around the fire, and if you want to, we have puppies that you can snuggle with. So yeah. Did your mushrooms explain the difference to you between your Siberian and your Alaskan huskies? Not for you guys a little bit. So the Siberians or Malamutes are your really big fluffy dogs. What people will usually think of when they imagine dog sledding, that's kind of what you'll see in like Balto or Togo movies. And those dogs did pull sleds back in the day, but they would haul freight and cargo using a sled like this. So your freight sled sits very low to the ground, made of wood, so it's very heavy, very sturdy, and does not move around much. So you're not going very fast with this sled, you're not going in and out of narrow trail. It would have just gotten all of your goods safely from one place to another. Those dogs also wore a different style of harness. So their harnesses would look like this. You've got the dog's head that goes here, arm on either side, and this post would get put behind the dog's tail. So when they're pulling those heavy loads, all that power could be in the front, in the shoulders, and none of the weight sat on your dog's hips. So you can think of those dogs like your bodybuilders. They are very, very strong, but they're very bulky, very slow, and not very good for running fast. In the 50s and 60s, mushers wanted a faster dog. The planes and trains had taken over for the distribution of supplies, so they started mixing Siberians, Malamutes, Shepherds, Labs, Hounds, anything to make a better sled dog. And all of these dogs are bred for how well they pull a sled and not at all what they look like, because that doesn't determine if they're good at pulling a sled or not. So you probably did see some of those Lab, Shepherd, or Hound traits coming through in some of these dogs. Since about the 70s, nothing else has been heavily mixed in, but those traits definitely still come through. They also changed the sled. So whereas that sled weighs about 60 pounds and can hold up to 1,000 pounds worth of cargo, this sled weighs about 30 pounds. Filled with all your gear, it's going to be less than 100 pounds. It also has a lot more flexibility and wiggle room to it. So you're going to be going a lot faster with this sled and a lot more narrow trail. And when you're steering a sled, you need to shift your body weight back and forth so that you don't hit any trees. So they made the sled a bit more flexible so that you don't run yourself into any trees. Pretty important. In the early 70s, dog sledding was starting to die out as a whole, largely due to the snowmobile. So it was becoming a lot easier just to gas up and care for one or two snow machines than it was to feed and harness 15 to 20 dogs. Joe Reddington Sr. noticed that trend of dog sledding starting to die out and wanted to get people excited about the race again. So he started the Iditarod, which is an 1,100-mile dog sled race here in Alaska. You've also got the Yukon Quest. That's another 1,000-mile race, started about 10 years later, and not by Mr. Reddington, but just as a way to further promote dog sledding and keep people excited about it. To run the Iditarod, you're going to have a team of 14 dogs, starting here in Anchorage, making your way to Nome. There's two routes the mushers are going to go, so the even years are going to go north, and odd years are going to go south. When he created the race, he wanted to involve as many native interior villages as he could, and doing two alternate routes just helped him do that a little bit easier. And then for reference, we are right here in Juneau, so it kind of shows you where we're at on the map here. You'll see these boxes along the way are your different checkpoints. So there's 20 checkpoints, ranging from 20 to 100 miles apart in distance. You have to stop at each checkpoint so a race vet can look at all the dogs on the team and make sure everybody's staying healthy. If one of your dogs develops a stomach bug, sore wrists, sore shoulder, they can be taken out of your team and they're going to stay with the vets. The mushers will continue in the race but with one less dog. So they're going to start with 14. They can drop them along the way, but they cannot add any new dogs in. You do have to finish and pull into Nome with at least 5 dogs on your team. So it can't be you and 1 or 2 Alaskan Huskies. Most teams that are finishing are coming in with between 8 to 12 dogs. And any that got dropped along the way will get flown to the starting or finishing line, depending on where's closer to home for the musher.